So good afternoon, Abhilasha. This is I'm Deepthi from Curious Times. I welcome you to yet another edition of the Ed Leaders, the special magazine that we are taking out this Teacher's Day. And I want to thank you for accepting the invite to be part of this magazine. And thank you so much.
Thanks a lot, Deepthi. It is, in fact, my honor and my privilege to be here and to be sort of connecting with a global audience. So it's actually I'm very thankful to you.
Thank you so much. So, Abhilasha, what we'll do is we'll quick do some bit of discussion about your own journey, a little bit about your school, and what were your inspirations to join the space, then what keeps you going, and then, you know, maybe touch upon how education has changed over the years and how you and your institute being sort of, you know, managing at your end about the changes that are happening. And yeah, so maybe sure. You can start with the school and then maybe talk about your own journey towards this.
Thanks, Deepthi. Just keep me on track because I, sort of go off track telling stories. So if I'm taking too much time, just get me back.
No problem.
These are the
stories.
So, I started teaching, well, it's been almost 23 years now, 1996. I started my teaching career in Meerut with Meerut Public School.
Okay.
I'm married to a service officer, so my husband is an army veteran. And at that time, when I got married, did not have a big ambition. And did not want to work at all. So, but, you know, one knows about women empowerment and knows that you need to work.
Yeah.
Well, plain and simple. Yeah. You need to work. It's not even like you want to work. You need to work.
Yes.
So teaching was the best profession that suits army vibes. So I simply started teaching with that. And the first 1 week in the school, I fell in love with teaching. And I didn't want to do anything else after that. I decided I want to be a teacher throughout my life.
Right.
And that is the power of teaching. You know, right. When you realize that so much you shape and the young beings that go through your hand and the empowering feeling that you get when you understand that you are a nation builder.
Right, right.
So from there, then I went on to, I moved with my husband throughout the country, wherever the army postings take you. And sorry for the disturbance, this will keep happening.
No problem.
I'm in my office. Yeah. And moving across India and finally to a foreign destination in Seychelles. It is there where I actually 2003 where I learned hands-on what you had learned in theory in BEd, and
right.
From there I have seen myself changing as a teacher and then moving on to become the leader that I am here today.
Right.
And there are very specific milestones in my career journey which I would like to acknowledge, because the teacher I am today, the teacher I became, and the leader I am today has been shaped by my mentors in these places where I have worked and learned.
Right.
So independent school, Seychelles, Mrs. Marcian, who took me under her wings, being a different culture, a different country. And then coming to Pine Grove School in Himachal Pradesh, where Captain Ajay Singh, our headmaster, whom we love and adore, and who has instilled in us the qualities of a good teacher, a professional, and a good leader. From him, I have learned that how good leaders create leadership in others.
Right.
And then from there, I went on to move to through Haryana, and then I landed up in UAE in 2015 to New Indian Model School.
Right.
And it is in New Indian Model School under Dr. Aslam Khan that I realized the potential that I have, because there you also discover yourself through your journey in life, you know.
Right.
So
right.
I did not. It was very. I mean, it was astonishing at the same time. Very. it was also empowering for me to understand that, wow, I was capable of doing this.
Right.
Because, you know, good leaders do that to you. Good leaders don't sort of thwart you. They create space around you to expand your wings. And when you do that, and you realize that there's so much that you are capable of doing, and
right.
and how does that happen is that you see the work through your students. Your students get impacted by your work. So your empowerment also results in empowering of your students.
Students.
That has been my journey in New Indian Model School, and I'm very, very thankful to the school for what they, like, you know, gave me and allowed me to do, because it is through that work that I am now here, a principal in Shining Star International School in Abu Dhabi.
Right. Tell us a little bit about your school, your current school.
So Shining Star is located in Mustafa area in Abu Dhabi. Right. And we serve the expat community in the area, in the region. It is a fairly young school. We are 6 years old. This is our seventh year going.
Right.
And in these 6 years, the school has made rapid strides in moving from, say, being a weak school to being a band B, a strong school. And then now, I took over the school in 2019.
Right.
So... Since then, I came with lots of dreams for this and my vision for the school with a big action plan. But yeah. then, you know, COVID-19 had us all sort of taking a step back and everything was put on hold. But then again, with COVID-19 also, we managed to do a lot of work with the children.
Right.
And engaging the parent community. So we've got a lot of things happening in the school. We are a Global School Alliance member school. We are a Global Program School members, which is schools are selected based on how well they are embedding sustainable UN Sustainable Development Goals yeah. in the curriculum, so Education for Sustainable Development Goals.
Right.
We are a T4 school. We were selected amongst the top 100 school last year by right. T4 Education to showcase to share our best practices in World Education Week.
Right. Right.
And we're hoping for the result this year as well.
Right.
And we have, I'm a Teach SDG ambassador, and we have 5 more Teach SDG ambassadors in school.
Right.
MIE expert. So, you know, that's work in motion at the moment.
Right. No, absolutely. Very, very inspiring journey, I would say. Because I think the thing is, like, when you just navigate your way upwards and you're not consciously doing something, but things are also happening along the side, as even when you set mini milestones and they keep happening, then you're up for something big. So many congratulations for
your
journey as well as your school. So Abhilasha, obviously Abu Dhabi could be slightly more, evolved, as your school as could be like, you know, really more evolved and from a resources perspective and all that. We talked to various schools last year and we obviously could not have a discussion with you, but, we saw like the pandemic bring a lot of changes in, the Indian ecosystem, at least from a teaching perspective. Help us understand how were things happening at your end, and as a leader, what were the decisions that you were supposed to take in a week or, in half a day, and how you were also working towards those challenges to make them a success?
We COVID-19 and the surprises, the disruption and everything, it was, I mean, sudden for everyone. But then I am very confident when I say this, that we were somewhat prepared, because my teachers were already conducting asynchronous lessons, preparing asynchronous lessons for Project Kakuma. Kakuma refugee camp in Kenya.
Right.
So being a part of Innovation Lab Schools, being a member of Innovation Lab Schools, which is founded by Kuhn Timmers,
right.
And also being part of Take Action Global, So yeah. We do a lot of volunteer work. I personally used to engage, and then when I came to the school, I also saw an opportunity to engage my teachers for them to have a worldview and also empathize with people who from less privileged backgrounds. So quality education number four, nobody to be left behind, being the heart of this work. And being educators, so I engaged my teachers, were very enthusiastic about it, and they signed up to become volunteers. And they were conducting, according to the Kenyan curriculum, asynchronous lessons, video lessons for the students along with the lesson plan and everything. So, that way, it was not very difficult for us to sort of think about or even, so let's say, envision that how will this happen?
Right.
And so that's one. And I personally have been doing a remote work with the UN Women. I was in the draft committee, so we did a lot of work on Google Documents. People are connected from different parts of the world at the same time, working through online, connected through Zoom meetings and working on that draft document. So that way, one did have a knowledge of how these things worked.
Right.
And then is also the experience of being a co-host with Microsoft Education for the Twitch meet in March.
Right.
And this particular thing gave me an experience on Microsoft Teams platform.
Yeah.
Okay. So, they trained us on different tools, and the meetings used to be held on Teams. And so the navigation of the platform. So the day ADEC called us for an emergency meeting of principals, in the first week of March to declare that, I think it was 6th of March or 8th of March. So to get us on board about, we are moving into distance learning and what all are the expectations and what you're going to do. So I came back home from that meeting. I reached home in the evening and immediately I called for an HOD meeting and told them on Teams.
Right.
On Teams, I called them. I said, this is what is happening and this is what we are using and this is how it is going to happen. So right. that way it was quite a smooth transition for us.
Right.
And
right.
given also the fact that we use Microsoft Education Center for our PD, for professional development.
Yeah.
So it is a self-paced learning program. It is asynchronous. So there the teachers, it is mandatory program in school. All the teachers have to take the Microsoft Innovative Educator Certificate from there.
Right.
From the platform. And
right.
then Microsoft has curated a lot of courses on how to use OneNote Teacher. So there's a OneNote Teacher Academy,
right.
How to use Microsoft Teams for inclusive classroom, how to manage hybrid learning environment with Microsoft Teams. So that way the teachers were then, guided to do this course.
Right.
We of course had our training sessions in the school. So
right.
that way it was quite a smooth transition for us.
Right.
And along with that, what we did was we also did training for parents.
Right.
We made changes into the curriculum. We all know CBSE has helped a lot.
Right.
With the annual academic calendar and conducting webinars for the teachers and getting everybody on board and,
right.
Getting all the leaders, guiding leaders, how to go about it. And then, of course, all the schools have their own wherewithal to adapt and accommodate the changes.
Right.
So that way we had smooth transition with a lot of help from the government also.
Right.
We were helped with devices. We were helped with the government came forward to help the students, schools with providing devices, SIM and routers for the students who had a device challenge.
Right, right.
So we're very thankful to the government of UAE, to ADEC especially for helping, making these the resources available for the schools.
I'm happy that, so much could be pulled out, together by you and your faculty. Congratulations once again. Taking one more step, you're affiliated to CBSE. Would NEP 2020 also, be part of your new curriculum and agenda?
Of course. And NEP could not have come at a better time, the apt opportune time, I would say, that when this disruption happened and we all were looking for, everybody is in this phase now, or that zone now that you are looking for a change and you are more accommodating to change.
Correct.
You're also more open. You have an open mindset and you are aware of what is required, what is needed. Right. And at this point, we are also at the education reimagining phase.
Right.
So, you know, we looking at education vision 2040, how the world is going to be, what is going to be the landscape of right. employment, of economy, and education and economy and employment is interlinked. So that way, we are very ready, we are absolutely on the brink of sort of exploding into, come on, like, you know, bring right. it on, and we want this and we are going to do it. So that way we made changes into our curriculum.
Right.
We revised and have incorporated the Universal Design for Learning in right. our curriculum. Is in fact that is the backbone of our curriculum.
Correct.
And looking at our vision of creating global citizens through innovation and creativity. So the heart of this, of the work in the school goes in that direction.
Right. So, you know, you've worked in India and you've worked overseas and you've been part of these global programs. Now, you know, here, India, you know, the landscape, because you've also worked you know, in the length and breadth of the country because of you working with army schools or, you know, getting posted in various locations, which would have different types of challenges and everything. What are the, you know, two, three big differences that you see, you know, between India and where you are right now? And, you know, your recommendations to Indian systems, like, you know, hey, you know, this is very quick to follow. Let's just sort of also implement in India. It's good for children. It's good for the, you know, school processes or learnings. So what do you have any kind of learnings to share for our Indian audience also?
Deepthi, thank you for that question. And the difference in teaching in India and teaching over here. One is, very honestly, the, you know, the growth mindset that I have seen in UAE, and especially like I was working in Dubai before I came to Abu Dhabi, and the regulatory body for private schools over there is the KHDA, the Knowledge and Human Development Authority, and the schools are inspected every year based on the guidelines of the UAE school inspection framework.
Right.
That has been a great learning opportunity for any teacher who comes to UAE right. from any part of the world, and more so from our part of the world. Because right. in India, we are very used to teaching. First of all, we teach how we were taught. So we bring our experiences, our own experiences into the classroom.
Right.
Isn't it? And then we are still very teacher oriented. We're very teacher directed and teacher controlled. So it is a teacher centric class rather than we would like to be a student centric class. There is so much of pressure on board students for board examination results that principals don't allow leaders, PTT teachers, senior secondary teachers don't allow grade 11s to 12 students to step out of the classroom for any kind of extracurricular, co-curricular activity. It's always about finish the syllabus, portions have to be covered, and, you know, past paper practice and all that. They don't let the children breathe anything other than their syllabus, and that's not good.
Right.
That's not right. That's not right for this young group for their development.
Right.
So this is what, like, and I am a sports person. I'm a national level handball player. Okay. I now participate. I run marathons now. I know the importance of sports in a person's life.
Right.
And it's quite a sorry state of affairs that we don't expose our children to that kind of richness.
Right.
The children, PE period is just a PE period for the sake of, and it is used as an extra class. It is taken away to cover syllabus, and, you know, so these kind of things are there which can improve, which should improve, and hopefully with the new with the NEP in implementation, hopefully we will see that change happening. Our children, we need to ensure that we make them competent and independent learners.
Right.
And we create opportunities for them to exalt themselves as the young beings that they are, to learn skills, competencies, which not necessarily are, can be learned just through those syllabus coverage portions and ideas and strategies. So right. They need to, a lot of learning, or rather real learning, happens outside the classroom.
Right.
So project-based learning for students to, like, you know, have, even for that matter, service learning should be compulsory in the schools.
Right.
And this is something that I'm looking into implementing in my school, that that children should be given that area to, you know, to explore themselves and their potential, and also be of service to others. So empathy should be of every program in school. And this is something that I would like to talk about. What we are doing in school is we are innovating with the strategy of gratitude as pedagogy. So helping the children to be in the moment of gratitude, practice gratitude, and it is on the roll at the moment. So we'll see what impact it has. So I don't have any evidence to give for that, but research says that children who actually, with gratitude, you can impact students' achievements. So that's the journey that we are waiting to explore.
Right.
So this is like what it is, you know. So growth mindset in UAE, teaching here, learning about so many more expansions of learning, teaching and learning, and not just subjected to syllabus being covered in the school, preparing for inspection, knowing those 6 standards on which schools are inspected, getting to know that how leadership is so important to student achievements in school, right. And health and safety. So no, these are the things that are a bit unique and also like a high focus here. Whereas in India, Indian students are known for their knowledge. They're known for their content, for excelling in studies. And our children do very well abroad when they go. And in fact, NASA,
right.
So many universities in abroad. I mean, it's evident enough that Indian students do well.
Right.
Yeah, they're very good at information acquisition, knowledge acquisition. But at the same time, there's also a need where our children need to, learn about much more than just syllabus.
Right. Yeah. So, I would just want to sort of also understand why you've sort of touched upon some of the things, in the context of NEP, in the context of technology, in the last 4-5 years, taking care of a lot of other things that, you know, maybe 10 years back, teachers would be struggling in terms of content, information, connecting to, global formats, etc. So, and there's a lot of help available on the internet about your own self-development and improvement, lots of programs and courses available. What do you think in the new sort of context and ecosystem that has got developed in terms of additional resources available with teachers, what's the new role of teacher that looks like, for next 3 to 5 years, what will be in the next 3 to 5 years, what will this new role look like? Because that role probably is going to define like what set of people actually join teaching as a profession, or what should teaching people who've joined the teaching professions look to that's going to happen in next 3 to 5 years. And therefore, this is your new role, and therefore this is how you want to prepare for it, right?
Deepthi, we all have heard that teaching is a work of heart, and teaching is a calling. So first and foremost, to answer the question, teachers have to make teaching profession, have to join the profession of teaching as a choice and as a first choice and not as the last choice.
Right.
Because this is actually what I have seen. I'm sorry, I'm being very honest and brutally honest about it. But then this is what we have seen, that in India, people will try first and foremost all the other those high focus areas of work.
Yeah.
And when all the competition, when nothing else works, then they go and do the BEd and say, "Achha, teaching to hai, chalo, teaching to mil." Like, you know, you can become a teacher.
Yeah, correct.
But not understanding that the work of teaching is that profession that creates resources for other human resources, for shapes human resources for other jobs and other employment. So
first and foremost,
for any teacher who wants to, for any person who wants to become a teacher, it has to first, they have to feel that importance of being a nation builder.
Right.
And keep teaching as a first choice, because we have seen it in school. Many principals will agree on this, that we have seen teachers who become teachers, but actually their heart is not in the work, and therefore they don't become good teachers.
Right. No, that's...
then they are teachers, of course. Like, you know, so a work of a teacher is, now we have come to understand that a teacher's work is to facilitate learning in the class.
Right.
She has to step back from that role of a teacher, and she has to be in that role of a facilitator, where the teacher takes a step back to create space around the children, around the students, around the learners, to ensure that learning happens.
Right.
Because when you're a teacher, when you teach, you teach.
Right.
But you need to confirm that whether learning has taken place.
Yeah, right.
So in that role of a facilitator, the teacher guides, teacher supports, teacher, the facilitator scaffolds, and ensure that good learning takes place.
Right.
This is where the role of a teacher is going to continue. And teaching is becoming a very demanding profession. It is not those, the teaching in the old days where you went to the class, you taught and you checked notebooks, and there was exam at the end of the year or mid-year or a different terms in the school.
Right.
Teaching is very demanding. There are high expectations, because we know the kind of learners that we want to create and all develop, empower, and so that after grade 12, when the child leaves and the school and steps into the field of higher education, we are releasing an independent learner who will be capable of looking after, is skilled to look after his own needs and continue with life with all those values that the school has instilled in the student, in the learner.
Right.
So that, but and teachers also need to understand that this Generation Z is smarter than them.
Yes.
Especially where technology is concerned, they are much, much smart. So we need to use the learner's smartness to again facilitate good learning in the lessons.
Totally.
So getting to know your students' capabilities and their competencies to be able to individually, you know, impact each and every child, that's really important. So the role of teacher in the shape of a facilitator, to be able to guide their students, to know what lays ahead, and be that friend, philosopher, and guide to them.
Right.
That old saying of being a teacher is my friend, philosopher, and guide, that remains.
Implement, yeah. Right? Yeah. So, you know, I'll not take too much of your time. I would sort of, you know, right now say that you guys are celebrating Teachers Day with us, which is, we are very thankful for that. There are lots of readers and viewers who would be like watching this interview. And I would request you to give a message for your own school students as well as the children on Curious Times. They have just like so much has evolved and changed. They also have their pressures. They have, pressures which are in terms of social media, emotional pressures because of lockdowns and inavailability of friends. And, you know, and generally in terms of competition, which, you know, our generation has created for them, right? So what's your message to them? Like, you know, they're going to be sending lots of cards and well wishes for all the teachers on Curious Times. I want to know from you, what do we say to them?
Thank you for that, Aditi, again. Well, to the children, first of all, thank you so much in advance for the teacher, Happy Teachers Day messages that you would be sending across. And remember, and I would like to quote Ms. Jane Goodall over here of Roots and Shoots Schools, Foundation Schools. Miss, one of the quotes of Ms. Jane is that we are all given the ability to do something in life. We must decide what that something is. It's not verbatim. I'm relaying the content. I mean, as a message, and this is important because we get this life once, and we are and this is very precious. So we must do what we can to leave a positive impact on the world. Right. We must empathize. We must be empathetic human beings to be able to help the underprivileged and be thankful for what we have and help the have-nots.
Right.
Secondly, be a global change maker. Global. Think global, act local. Understand your generation by 2030 will be moving into either employment, higher education, or you would just be leaving school. So the world that you want to see 9 years ahead of present, this is the decade of action. Sustainable UN Sustainable Development Goals, Agenda 2030 is a collective responsibility. Ensure that you are doing your bit to achieve Agenda 2030, to achieve global goals. Pick up any one goal that is very close to your heart. Make it your personal goal. Drive the community to achieve that goal.
Right.
Make your life useful. Don't live for yourself. Live for others.
Right.
Thank you. Thank you.
That's wonderful. Thank you so much once again, Abhilasha, for being with us. And we wish you, your faculty, colleagues, everybody a very happy Teachers Day. And we look forward to staying in touch with you guys, for a long, long time. And thank you so much for being part of the EdLeaders.
Thank you so much, Deepti. I look forward to reading Curious Times.
Yeah. Okay, thank you so much. Bye.